Yes, sir.
हेलो।
यस सर।
हाँ मैंने हाँ मैंने कर दिया। ठीक है।
ओके। Okay guys, good morning. We will start the class in 5 minutes. Hello.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How are you?
Good, sir.
How many of you are there? Paras, I can say. Paras, Ardra, Samyukta is there. Only four of you. Where are others? Any idea? No. How is Aditya, Paras?
Sir, he's in Thailand.
Any conversation?
I don't know when he's coming back only.
Okay. Okay, so we'll start today. Polymers. Okay. It's a small chapter, we can finish it today itself. I have shared one video yesterday on the group. That video is on surface chemistry. Okay, I'll take that class, surface chemistry. It's not like I won't take. I take that class. But if you get time, you can go through once. Okay, I'll discuss that when I take the class of surface chemistry. Okay. So, just a second. Screen is visible?
Yes, sir.
Oh, just a second. To save it. Okay. We'll just delete this board and we'll start. Okay, so we'll start with polymers. Okay. What is a polymer? Any idea? Anything you can say about this? Tell me.
Association of molecules.
Association of molecules. Any example of polymers?
Nylon.
Like no, in daily use, anything that we use, which comes under this category. Tell me.
Can it be like an organic polymer also?
Anything.
Sucrose.
What? Sucrose. Okay. Yeah. Okay. What about the bottle that we use, water bottle? Is that a kind of polymer? The wire that we use, the cable wire. Okay. The laptop, this buttons that you have, keys, or this material of this laptop. Okay. Cable wire that we have, any kind of wire you see. Switchboard is a kind of polymer. Plastic box that we use in kitchen to keep those, you know, pulses and spices and all. Those plastic box are also a kind of polymers. Okay. Anything like polymers has a very vast application in our day-to-day life. Every day we use different kinds of polymers. Okay. So that's why you know, the application of this is very huge in our day-to-day life. That's why this industry is very big. Polymer industry is very big. Okay. The fiber pipes that we have, the pipe that we use for the flow of water from the water tank to, you know, in the tap and all, kitchen, everywhere, washroom, wherever we use those pipes. Okay. So all those materials comes under the category of polymer. Okay, depending upon the strength required for a given purpose, we build the polymer and then we use it. Okay, so that's why, like I said, the industry is very big, and we on a daily basis we use these kind of polymers. Okay, so that's why when you do some research work, masters in polymer technology and all, there is a very good scope of, you know, good career opportunity we have it. Because like I have given you many examples that comes under polymers and we use daily in our life. Okay. So that's how the thing is. Like, so polymers are what? Polymers are made up of two or more different kinds of molecules. Okay. Different or same kinds. Anyone you can take. Okay. Two or more different or same kind of compounds. These compounds are the basic constituents, okay? The basic constituents of the polymers, and we call it as monomers. Okay, you must have heard about monomer, dimer, and all, right? So dimer comes under the category of polymer because we define what? When two or more substance combines together to give a large complex structure, that compound is known as polymer. Okay. So application of polymers, uses we have discussed. Okay. Now we are going to see in this chapter. The chapter is theoretical. Okay. You won't get any numericals question to this. The point is you need to know for a given compounds, what is the monomer of that? Okay. What kind of linkage is there? What is the repeating unit in the polymer? Okay. Those things you have to keep in mind. Okay. And since it is, we are doing this in chemistry, so we also have to see the reactions which involves in the formation of polymers. Okay. But like I said, reactions, hardly they ask in this. They will ask you the monomers of different polymers, the repeating unit. Okay. And what kind of linkage is there? Sometimes they ask. Okay, so all those things we'll discuss one by one. First of all, you'll write down the definition of polymers. Definition you write down. write down. Polymers are a very large complex molecules. Polymers are very large complex molecules which has very high molecular masses. Very high molecular masses. Masses. And each molecule consists of each molecule means polymer molecules. Each molecule consists of a very large number of simple structural units joined together through covalent bond. Each of these structural units are called monomers. Okay. Next line, the method or process by which monomers are monomers converts into monomers converts into polymers are called polymerization technique. And this phenomenon is polymerization. So this is the definition of polymer. Okay. But definition, obviously, they won't ask. Examples of polymers, I have given you many examples. Write down. The examples are, we have polyethylene. Polyethylene is nothing but polythene that we use, the plastic bag. E-T-H-E-N-E, polythene. Okay. We can have polyvinyl chloride, PVC. We can have nylon 66, etc. There are many other things. Okay, plastic bag, plastic box, okay, cable, okay, the electric board, switches, all these are examples of polymers, okay, which are there in day-to-day life that we use. Okay, now what I said, polymers are made up of what? Two or more monomer, basic structural unit which we call it as monomer. Two or more basic structural unit known as monomers. Okay, so these polymer can take same type of monomer also or different type of monomer also. Okay, so polymers, again we can classify this polymer into two types. Okay, based on the structural unit present. And structural unit means what? The monomers. Okay? Based upon the structural unit present. Two types of monomers we have, polymers we have based on the structural unit. The first type, we call it as homopolymers. Homopolymers, and the second one is copolymers. In homopolymers, the repeating structural unit, this you have to memorize this, you have to keep this in mind. The repeating structural unit are derived from only one type of monomer units. Only one type of monomer units. Okay. Same monomer will have in this. Okay, we cannot have different monomers. Like, you see, polyethylene, I have written here one example. Okay, the monomer of polyethylene is ethylene. And that's why the polymer of ethylene is polyethylene. Got it? Polymer of propylene is polypropylene. Okay, like that we write down the name. So with this polyethylene, what if somebody asks you, what is the monomer here? Remove this poly, you'll get the name of the monomer, that is ethylene. Okay, so polyethylene is a type of homopolymers. That's what you have to memorize. Okay, they may ask you this question, they'll give you four options and they say which one of these is homopolymer or copolymer. Okay, so you should know the definition of it. What is homopolymer? What is copolymer? Then only you can say whether the repeating structural unit, which is nothing but monomers, okay, we have either we have same type of monomers or different types of monomers. Okay, we are not concerned with the number of monomers present, but we have to see like whether we have same kind of monomer like in polythene or different kind of monomer. I'll give you the example of that also. Okay. So, homopolymers are those polymers where the repeating structural unit are same. Only one type of repeating structural unit. Copolymer, it is reverse of it. In copolymers, what happens? We have different repeating structural unit. Okay, means the two monomers that we use here are simply in one line we'll write down. For copolymers, we use different types of monomers. Of a structural unit, which is monomers. Got it? The example of copolymer is nylon 66. we'll do one by one the different polymers we have, and then there also we'll see this one is homopolymer, this one is copolymer. Just you copy it down first.
Copy it, sir.
Done, sir.
Done? Okay. See, this is one type of classification we have, which is based on the structural unit present. Okay. Classification of polymer is also there on the basis of source. So write down the next one. Classification based on, I'll just write down the second one here. The heading is classification based on source. Based on source, we have two types of polymers. One is natural polymers, which exist naturally. That's the name suggest. Write down just one line. Polymers which are found in nature. Like animal plants are natural polymers. Okay, like starch. Example, I'll write down here. Natural polymers, the examples are starch, cellulose, protein. Proteins, nucleic acid. Nucleic acid, etc. Nucleic acid, we haven't done, no, in biomolecules?
No, sir, that part was left out.
Achha, I'll do that. Nucleic acid, kar lenge hum log. It takes half an hour. Okay, we'll finish that. It's not that important for, you know, chemistry point of view, but we'll go through once. Okay, we'll do that. Okay, these are natural polymers. Second one is synthetic. Synthetic means what? Man-made. Any example of synthetic polymers?
Nylon, rayon.
Yes. Nylon, polythene, polystyrene, PVC, bakelite, dacron. Write down all these examples. Nylon, polyethylene, polystyrene, PVC, polyvinyl chloride, bakelite, dacron, D-A-C-R-O-N. Okay. Now, the another type of classification we have, which is based on structure. I'm not giving you this, just you listen to me. Based on structure, we have linear polymers, branched chain polymers, and three-dimensional network polymers. Okay? In three-dimensional network polymers, there are cross-linked. I'll just draw the structure here. You see, the first one we have, like, theory I am not giving you, just you draw the structure because these are not important. Based on source, classification based on source, you write down. See, one thing I'll tell you here, that for these chapters, okay, like we have polymers, biomolecules, to a certain extent, biomolecules to a certain extent, then surface chemistry, chemistry in everyday life. For these chapters, NCERT is more than enough. You don't have to read any other book, okay, from beginning to end. The focus should be on NCERT. They prepare questions directly from NCERT. They pick one or two lines and they prepare questions from that. Okay, so my suggestion is I'll cover everything here in the class. But when you want to go through on your own, just read NCERT. For questions, you can refer the assignments or any other book. Okay. But for theory part, don't go to any other book that you have. NCERT is more than enough for theory. Okay. So theory part will focus on whatever, theory given in NCERT, not more than that. Okay. Based on structure, we have three types of polymers. The first one is linear polymer. Ab dekho, is the name suggest? Linear polymer mein kya hoga? Will have a linear structure. This mein koi bhi branched nahi hoga.
Sir, it should be based on structure, man.
Based on structure, yes. It is source I have written by mistake. Make it structure. It means you are not sleepy. Yes, Paras.
Sir, I woke up.
What? Based on structure. Okay, so like I said here, there is linear polymer. There's no branch into it. It's a linear polymer like this. So it's just a one layer. So you can have another layer like this one. Like this. So it is a linear polymer. Oh, it looks good. Second one we have branched chain polymer. Like the name suggests, in this we have branches also. For example, you see, this is the polymer we have, suppose. And in this, we have branches present like this. This is branched chain polymers. Third one is we have three-dimensional sheet structure. Three-dimensional network polymers also we call it as. Three-dimensional. Network polymers. Three-dimensional network polymers. In this, we have cross-linking. Write down. In this, we have cross-linking. Cross-linking means what? Suppose this is the layer one. Another layer. We have another layer like this. All these layers, like here, these are linked together by some bonds. Okay, this is cross-linking. See, this one is cross-linking. Like this, the cross-linking were present. Okay, so write down, this is the cross-linking we have. So because of this cross-linking, their strength increases a bit. Okay? So these kind of polymers are either hard, rigid, and brittle.
So can you give an example for a 3D thing?
Acha, I'll give you. Write down, these are hard, rigid, and brittle. The example of this is bakelite. Urea formaldehyde polymer. Write down. Urea formaldehyde polymer, bakelite, melamine formaldehyde polymer. I'll give you examples for all three. Because examples are important here. For this, it is polythene. Nylons, polyesters. Nylons, polyesters. For this one, we have glycogen, amylopectin. Amylopectin is there in amino acids. We'll discuss that. One type of amino acid we have this. And this is bakelite, urea formaldehyde, and melamine formaldehyde polymers.
So what kind is starch?
Sorry?
Starch comes under which category, sir?
Starch comes under the third one, three dimensions.
Because amylose and amylopectin.
Yes, because all these starch proteins, cellulose, they have very, very, very complex structure. Okay, very large, huge, complex structure we have. In all these, we have cross-linking, right? Last class, we were discussing, proteins, how they form. There will be cyclic, helical structure because of hydrogen bonding and all. So there are cross-linking present in all these kind of molecules. Starch, cellulose, proteins, and all. All these comes under three-dimensional network. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, there are a few examples we'll discuss. Like I said, other, classification also we have. Classification based on synthesis. Okay? How the polymers forms. Two types of reaction generally we have. Addition and condensation. Right? So that we call it as addition polymerization and condensation polymerization. Addition polymerization, two molecules joins together. Okay. In condensation, like molecules like H2O, NH3 goes out and they joins together. Okay. So that we'll discuss in reactions involved in polymerization. So that is also one kind of classification. And we say this as what? Based on synthesis. Means what reaction we are using for the synthesis of one kind of polymers. So that is also comes under classification, but we'll do that in reactions involved in polymerization. Okay. So before going into that, there are a few examples that we should know. The examples. The first one is H2C double bond CH2. What is the name of this molecule?
Ethylene.
Okay, both we can say. So when it goes under polymerization, it gives you what? It gives you polyethylene or polyethene also you can say, which we use in plastic bags. So this is ethylene. And on polymerization, it gives polyethylene. Okay. What is the structure of this polyethylene? It is like this. We have CH2, 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 and so on. In short, we can also write this as open bond CH2, CH2, open bond, bracket, and N. This is actually represent that there are n such molecules present in this, and that's why this is polymer and the name of this is polyethylene. Am I clear? For polymerization, what happens? We should have a definite pressure, temperature, or catalyst. So whatever is required will provide here for this reaction, and then the reaction takes place. Okay, so the method by which this monomer, ethylene, this monomer converts into polymer, those methods are polymerization technique, And this phenomenon is polymerization. Okay. What is the use of polyethylene? Use in the formation of plastic bag. Joki banned ho gaya Bangalore mein. You know that?
Yes, sir.
If you're using plastic bag, if you're carrying some goods in the plastic bag, then they can ask you for 2,000 rupees fine. You know that? The shop se liya, shop wale ko 5,000, and the person who is taking goods into the plastic bag, they have to pay 2,000 rupees fine. Okay, so don't use plastic bag. So this is one uses of polyethylene. Now the reference molecule is this. On the basis of this only, we'll give you the another molecules, which is this. Now, if you remove one hydrogen here with chlorine, CH2, double bond CH, and here we have Cl. When you do the polymerization of it, what you'll get? First of all, you tell me the name of this compound. The name of this compound is what?
Chloroethene.
Okay.
Vinyl chloride.
Yes. At vinyl position, we have chlorine present. So this molecule is vinyl chloride. And the polymerization of this gives you polyvinyl chloride. Ethylene gives polyethylene. Vinyl chloride gives polyvinyl chloride. Got it? The structure is what? If you draw the structure, CH2CH. Cl connected with the other molecule CH2CHCl CH2CHCl and so on. In short, if I write this as CH2CHCl and n times. Okay. The example of this PVC, the use of this in making pipes banane mein use karte. Okay. One more thing I forgot to tell you here. What is the repeating unit? What is the repeating unit here? See, this n times means what? This is the repeating unit we have. So like this, you should know the repeating unit of the molecules. Like this one is easy, so you don't have to worry about it. They won't ask these questions also. But for others, we'll see what are the repeating units. There it is important. Okay, this kind of question they ask. Similarly, the repeating unit is this one here.
Is there a name for these repeating units?
It's vinyl chloride only for this one.
Hmm.
Name they won't ask. They'll draw the structure actually. Now, if I ask you, these two are homopolymers or copolymers?
Homopolymers.
Yes, because the monomer is same. We have only one type of monomer, right? That's why these are homopolymers, not copolymers. So like this, you have to keep in mind that whatever examples you are looking at, you should focus on the repeating unit, what kind of polymers it is, homopolymer, copolymer, and then what are the monomers. If it is homopolymer, fine, only one monomer will be there. If it is copolymer, then what are the two monomers we use for the production of this, and what is the uses? These two, three things you must focus on. Okay. Third type, if I remove this chlorine and add phenyl group, like this one. CH2 double bond CH. And here we have the benzene ring. So polymerization of this gives, the name of this compound is styrene. And the polymerization of this gives what?
Polystyrene.
Okay. The use of this is, I am not drawing the structure here again, but can you tell me what is the repeating unit of this?
CH2 single bond CH
phenyl ring and open bond both sides. N. Correct? Like that you can draw the structure. So I'm not drawing it here again because we know how to draw this. Another example, you see, we remove this benzene ring and we attach CN here, cyanide. This molecule, we call it as acrylonitrile, A-C-R-Y-O nitrile. And on polymerization, this gives what? Polyacrylonitrile. All these are homopolymers. This, we also call it as orlone. The name of polyacrylonitrile, the general name is orlone, O-R-L-O-N. Polyacrylonitrile we use for the formation of fibers. Uses. Fifth one, if I remove all the hydrogen atom and add fluorine, CF2 double bond CF2, polymerization. This compound is tetrafluoro tetrafluoroethylene is the monomer, and polymerization of this gives you the compound which we call it as Teflon. And the Teflon, that use of this is the formation of non-cookware.
Even mouse feet is made of Teflon.
Yes. Clear?
Yes, sir.
So these 4 or 5 examples you must remember. All these are examples of homopolymer, not copolymer. Okay? Yeah. Now the next thing is, what are the polymerization technique we have? That is reaction. What reactions involve in polymerization? Write down the reaction involved in just a second. Acrylonitrile vulcanization. Okay, so two types of polymerization reaction we have. So heading is polymerization reaction. Like I said, two types of polymerization reaction we have. The first one is addition polymerization. Addition polymerization leave some space here, and the second one you write down condensation polymerization. Condensation polymerization. Addition polymerization also we have three types in it. The first one is free radical polymerization. The second one is cationic polymerization. Polymerization. And the third one is anionic polymerization. Got it?
Yeah.
Condensation polymerization, what happens into this? The molecules like water, NH3, HCl, etc., goes out, eliminates, okay? And the two molecules combine. Okay, so these are the two types of reaction we have. First of all, we'll see free radical polymerization. So next heading you write down free radical, because cationic and anionic, we'll not go into that detail. I'll just give you the idea how it forms. Basically, the difference in these three reactions is what? The intermediate are free radical, cation, anion. That is the only difference. Okay. So reaction part is not that important, but free radical, we'll see that. Write down the first one, free radical polymerization. Free radical polymerization. See, free radical polymerization, this mechanism involves the formation of free radical. Okay? And that's why this, we also call it as chain growth polymerization. Because in free radical mechanism, we know there is initiation step, then chain propagation, then chain termination. So this we also call it as chain growth polymerization. Chain growth polymerization. And since free radical involves in this, so these kind of reaction is very difficult to stop. Difficult to stop means we do not have any control on this reaction. Okay, so that's why we most probably will get a very complex structure into it. If you try to control it, it's not possible, because the intermediate is free radical, which is highly reactive, and we know in free radical reactions we do not have any control into that. Okay, that is one thing. Now for this reaction, since it involves free radical, so this reaction actually requires a free radical agent, okay, which forms free radical generally. So for this reaction we need a free radical agent. Free radical agent are those molecules or compounds which helps in the formation of free radical. Okay, it helps in the formation of free radical. Like, for example, we can take any peroxide or oxygen. O2 as a catalyst we can take, or we can take any peroxide for this purpose. In general, we use benzoyl peroxide. As free radical agent. So benzoyl peroxide, if you look at the structure of benzoyl peroxide is this pH, C double bond O, and then we have a peroxide linkage, C double bond O and pH. Okay. So what happens with this benzoyl peroxide? All these peroxy compounds where we have this linkage, peroxy linkage, are generally not that stable. And when you heat this slightly, this bond dissociates and it forms a radical, which is pH, C double bond O, O radical plus pH C double bond O, O radical. Why this happens? Because these two oxygen has lone pair of electron on it. And that's why we have very high lone pair repulsion. And hence the dissociation of this bond is easier. Okay. So one of the electron here is taken up by this oxygen and another one is taken up by this oxygen. Okay. And it forms a free radical like this. We also know that this free radical has property to eliminate neutral molecule. Neutral molecule and forms new free radical. So in this, what happens? Two CO2 molecule eliminates. I'm writing down for both one. One CO2 from this, one CO2 from this eliminate. And we'll get two phenyl radical. I should write down this. We'll get two phenyl radical. Got it?
Yes, sir.
So this is the first step of the reaction. And this step, like I said, we call it as chain initiation step. Free radical mechanism, chain initiation step. Okay. Next step is what? Chain propagation. So in chain propagation, what happens? This phenyl radical in the next step. This phenyl radical has one free radical here. It reacts with the ethylene that you have and with a suitable pressure temperature catalyst. So here this one electron comes over here, one electron comes over here, and these two joins like this. So the product is this. CH, single bond CH2, radical. okay? Like this only, the chain propagates, okay? We have another molecule also. CH2 double bond CH2 combines with this here and we'll get a long chain. So in short, if I write down n times if this steps goes, then it gives pH CH2 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 radical. This is suppose n times. Like this compound will get CH2 radical. Okay. And finally, what happens? This one and this one club together because we have this kind of many compounds are there. So all these clubs together and it forms pH CH2 CH2 pH the whole thing. Suppose this is X number of times. Like this only. Okay. And finally, this pH goes out and we'll get a long chain compound here. So basically, this reaction involves, so this last step is chain termination. When all the free radical combines together, this step is chain termination. From here to here, it is chain propagation. And till here, it is chain initiation. Okay. So like you see, free radical involves in this reaction. So the structure of the polymer that you get here is very complex. There is no proper arrangement, order arrangement here. Why? Because the intermediate is free radical, which is highly reactive, and we do not have any control in such reaction. Copy it down.
So heating unit is just CH2, right? Both the
yes. Monomer is that only, no? CH2 double bond CH2. So with that only we'll get the repeating unit. For homopolymers, the repeating unit is not that important. For copolymer, it is important. We'll see that also. Can we go to the next page?
Yes.
Okay. So similarly, we have cationic polymerization. There the intermediate is in cation. Okay. Anionic polymerization, intermediate is in anion. Okay. So that mechanism, like I said, even this is also not important. The only thing is, if you have any cation, suppose H plus present, then this CH2 double bond CH2 will attack like this. If I write down here, you see. CH2 double bond CH2 we have with H plus. It forms CH3 CH2 plus. Now this reacts with again CH2 double bond CH2 and the reaction proceeds. Okay. So that's how the reaction goes in cationic polymerization. Anionic may will have this. If you have a salt like K NH2. So it is K plus NH2 minus. And when this reacts with CH2 double bond CH2. So in this, what happens? This minus attacks onto this carbon and this goes here. So we'll get CH2, NH2, NH2, CH2, and CH2 negative. So this is cationic polymerization, this is anionic polymerization. Again, this negative charge will attack onto this molecule, shift, and we get a long chain compound. That's how it goes. So like I said, it is not important. okay, the mechanism here. Okay. This is the three reaction we have: addition and addition polymerization, which involves free radical, cationic polymerization, and anionic polymerization. The another one we have here is condensation polymerization. Okay, so in condensation polymerization, what happens? Like I said, the neutral molecules like H2O and NH3 goes out. So the second reaction we have look at this reaction. This molecule reacts with glycol, which is HO CH2 CH2OH. So what happens in this, when you heat this, H2O molecules goes out. H2O molecules goes out and these two combine. So minus H2O and the product will be HO C double bond O, a benzene ring, C double bond O, OCH2, CH2OH. Okay, this molecule, the name of this molecule is terphthalic acid. And this one is glycol. The polymer that you get here, we call it as terylene, polyester, or dacrone. I'll write down the name. But first of all, you see here, these two combines, and in the next step, since we have two different monomers here, so which one we can use in the next step to get the large complex structure, polymer structure? Which of these two monomers we should use in the next step? Tell me.
If we want complexity, then terephthalic.
Which one?
That acid thing.
Acha. See, actually, you see, this end is an acid, right? This end is an acid. And this is an alcohol. So actually, we can use any one of these, monomers in the next step. The only thing is, if you use alcohol here, the reaction takes place with the acid end. If you take acid here, then the reaction takes place with the alcohol end. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Right. So now you see, suppose I am taking this acid in the next step, which is, in short, I'll write down PHCOOH and COOH. Then the reaction takes place here, right? Alcohol end. From here to this CH2, the thing will be same. The structure is HO, C double bond O, C double bond O, O CH2, CH2, and then again H2O goes out. So this connect with an oxygen, C double bond O, then benzene ring, C double bond O, OH. Okay, C double bond O, OH. Now you see here, in the next step, now we are bound to use what? We're bound to use?
Only the alcohol.
Because both end we have what? We have acid. So basically we'll go alternate in this way. Okay. First we can use in the first step, we get this, and then we can use any one of these monomers, alcohol or acid. But if you use alcohol here, next will be acid. If you use acid here, next will be alcohol. And like that we'll go alternate. Okay. Now the thing is, if this reaction takes place, I'll write down one more step here. The product is this we get. After this reaction, the product is this. We have H O C double bond O C double bond O O CH2 CH2 O C double bond O, and then we'll have a ring C double bond O O CH2 CH2 OH. This is the product we get after this reaction. Now you tell me here, what is the repeating unit for this monomer? So for this polymer. So give me a minute, I'm coming. Just tell me find out the repeating unit in this. Yes, tell me. The repeating unit?
Sir, is it O C double bond O phenyl C double bond O O CH2 CH2 O?
I think it's only till CH2 CH2.
Till CH2 CH2?
Oh, yeah. That comes from the other thing.
Okay, just a second. Okay, so the repeating unit here is from this C double bond O. We'll take this here. This C double bond O to this oxygen. One change I have to do here. This is OH, and this is the structure. So this side also the change we have is this, which is OH here, and this will take this hydrogen. This hydrogen. So repeating unit is this. So this you should know for a given polymer. And what kind of the name of this polymer is, we call it as pterylene. Okay. Which we also known as this as polyester. Because you see COR group we have, so it is polyester, okay? And the common name is dacron also, D-A-C-R-O-N, dacron, okay? So all these names are important. So basically dacron or polyester or pterylene is a copolymer or homopolymer?
It's a copolymer.
It is a copolymer because two different monomer we are using. So that's what you need to keep in mind, okay? The difference in this condensation and addition polymerization is what? That this reaction we can stop at any step. You won't heat it, reaction won't go in the next step. Okay, so this can be stopped. The reaction is under control. That's what we can say. The reaction is under control. Unlike the addition polymerization, where we have no control on the reaction. So that's the difference we have here. Okay. Some more example we'll see. Can you tell me the formula of adipic acid? Yes.
Don't know, sir.
Don't know. I have given you this though in carboxylic acid chapter.
Could you repeat which acid?
Adipic acid. Just a second. adipic acid. Don't know. Do you remember this?
CH2COOH.
Here we have COOH. And this is N times. So if N is 0, what is the name of the molecule? Because it is COH, COH. Because there is no CH2 present in between when N is 0. When N is 1, malonic acid. When N is 2, succinic acid. When N is 3, glutaric acid. When N is 4, it is adipic acid. And when N is 5, it is pimelic acid. Okay, so I have given you this. How do you memorize this? 0 to 5 N, OMSGAP. Remember this? Ohm's cap. Yes? So this you must remember. It helps you in getting the formula of the molecule. So adipic acid and hexamethylene diamine. So adipic acid, the formula is HOOC CH2. What is the N value for adipic acid?
4.
So this is 4 COOH. And this combines with hexamethylene diamine. Okay. So hexamethylene diamine is this. CH2, NH2. Here also we have NH2. Hexamethylene, so CH2, 6. Got it? So the second one is, this molecule is hexamethylene. Diamine. Okay. When condensation takes place between the two, H2O molecules goes out and it forms the product here is HOC double bond O CH2 4C double bond O combines with NH. Should we have O? We don't have O here. Sorry. C double bond O, OH and H forms H2O. And it gives NH CH2 6NH2. This is the compound we get. The repeating unit, if you see, it is from this C double bond O to, I'll write down this way, wait. Hydrogen. The repeating unit will be from here to this hydrogen. N times of this gives you the polymers. Okay. So, this molecule, this polymer, in general, we call it as polyamide. Why polyamide? Because in this, we have amide linkage, COONH bond. So it is an amide linkage. Okay. So in the polymer like this, we have many amide linkage. That's why we call it as polyamide. Okay. And this commercial name of polyamide, we also call it as nylon. What? 6, 6.
So does condensation polymerization happen only for copolymers?
Not necessary. It is possible with homopolymers also. If you have, suppose, two molecules of adipic acid, then also it's possible. Okay, but yes, in that case, you'll get a molecule which has a bond of C double bond O, O, C double bond O. Okay, so that is an ester kind of molecule you'll get. But it is possible with homopolymers also, in homopolymers also. Like two carboxylic acid may combine, no? Water molecules goes out. So it is possible over there also. Condition but will be different. Huh?
It may stop after dimer itself, no, sir, because
it will become... So dimer is also a polymer, no? And why would it stop? Suppose one end we have this end, we have COOH open. Okay. Then we can take another same. This end will have. Is open. No, suppose you have COOH, COOH this side also. These two react. You'll get a dimer. This end and this end is open. So now this end will react or this end will react. So like this it goes. If condition is not there, then it stops, huh?
Won't there be any repulsion because it's the same type?
If you compare, yes, there will be. But the question whether it is possible or not, it's possible.
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Nylon 6,6 is a commercial name for this. This 6 and 6 stands for the number of carbon atom in the two monomer. Here you see. The number of carbon atom is 6, 4, 5, and 6. So this 6 and 6 represents right down here the number of carbon atom present in the monomer. Okay. Polyamides. Nylon 66 is a polyamide. Okay, it has amide linkage, hence it is polyamide. CONH. Next. We have to discuss about the one last classification of polymers that is based on, write down, classification based on molecular forces. Based on molecular forces. Based on molecular forces. So depending upon the strength of the force that is involved in the polymers, this classification is done. Okay, and it is important. The first one is elastomers. Write down into this. In short, you write down, these are the polymers in which the intermolecular force of attraction is very weak. Elastomers, in short, you write down point wise. IMF, that is intermolecular force. So IMF is weakest here. And when IMF is weakest, so obviously the polymers can slide over the layer. Okay, we have layer by layer structure. So when intermolecular force is weak, then all these layers can slide onto each other, right? So that's why they have elasticity property. They have high degree of elasticity. High degree of elasticity. And what we say, they have ability to stretch over, you know, their normal length. Actually, 10 times of their normal length they can stretch, but that is not important. Okay. They have, the structure is irregular, write down, irregular shape. Irregular shape we have, and few cross links are there. And few cross links. Okay. Example you write down. Examples of elastomers are natural rubber. Natural rubber examples. Buna S. You know what is Buna S?
No, sir.
You do not know? Okay. Buna S is a copolymer. We'll discuss that. Buna S is a copolymer. We'll discuss that. Rubber, when we do rubber, we'll discuss into that only. I'll just write down the example now. Okay, Buna S. So, vulcanized rubber also, here we take as this thing, elastomers. Vulcanized rubber is important. They've asked this question many times in the exam. Vulcanized rubber. So, in this only, we'll discuss what is vulcanized rubber. So write down the heading. Write down. Write down the vulcanization is a process. Excuse me. Vulcanization is a process by which the tensile strength, elasticity, and resistance of natural rubber can be increased. Okay. Next line. In this process, the rubber is heating with sulfur, and in bracket you write down after sulfur, we use 3 to 5% of sulfur. Means the rubber is heating with 3 to 5% of sulfur. During vulcanization, the sulfur bridges. The sulfur bridges or the cross links, sulfur bridges or the cross links or the cross links forms between the polymer chain. And this is known as vulcanized rubber. This is known as vulcanized rubber. So basically, the natural rubber you have, suppose the rubber, natural rubber is this. We have different, chain. In this, we have natural rubber is this, suppose. This is natural rubber. And when you heat this with 3 to 5% sulfur, then there will be a crosslink of sulfur bridge between the polymer chain. Like this, suppose the chain we have. So all these will have sulfur bridges present between this. And that is how the strength increases, resistance increases. Like this, the chain forms. Okay, so this rubber, we call it as vulcanized rubber. This is natural rubber. So this vulcanized rubber, they have asked many times in the exam, competitive exam also they have asked, in board exam also they have asked, okay? So but there's only one thing you need to keep in mind, that the natural rubber is heated with 3 to 5% sulfur to give the rubber which has more tensile strength, resistance and all, that rubber we call it as vulcanized rubber. Generally, the question that they ask in competitive exam, in vulcanization, the rubber is heated with what? We'll have four options. Sulfur is the answer. Okay, so that is one type of, first classification of molecular, based on molecular forces we have of polymers, okay? Second one, write down, is fiber. Can we take a break now? Hello?
We'll now, take after fiber.
Huh?
You finish fiber, then we'll take some.
Okay, chalo. Fiber you write down.
The class is still
till one. Yeah. No, I'll take my breakfast. That's why I'm asking. Anyways, we'll finish.
Oh, okay.
No issue. 2 minutes we'll finish this fiber. Chalo. After this fiber, we'll take a break. Okay. Write down. In this, the intermolecular, here you see, intermolecular force is weakest here. And here the intermolecular force in fiber is the strongest. Okay, IMF strongest here. Write down. The forces involved in this, next line, the forces involved, you write down, hydrogen bonding or dipole-dipole interaction. Dipole-dipole interaction. Like in case of polyamides, nylons are polyamides. That also you must remember. Nylons are polyamides. Amide linkage is there. So in case of polyamides, the intermolecular force are due to hydrogen bonding. You must remember this. Polyamide mein we have hydrogen bonding. But when you have polyesters, like terylene dicrone that you have, polyesters, we have dipole-dipole interaction. In polyester and polyacrylonitrile, that is orlone. See, polyester is is dacron. And polyacrylonitrile is orlone. So in both we have dipole-dipole interaction. This you must remember for both the thing. Dipole-dipole interaction. So in all these comes under the category of fibers. Okay, they are very strong in terms of their strength. Okay, so when intermolecular forces are strong, they have obviously high tensile strength, the property. They have high tensile strength, okay, and less elasticity. Slippery tendency is not there, hence less elasticity. And the last thing you write down, they have high melting point, and low solubility. Examples, most important fibers, the examples are dacron, orlone, and polyamides. Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
So we'll take a break now. We'll start in 15 minutes. What's the time now?
10:41.
Yeah.
We'll start 10:55. Okay, chalo, take a break. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So fibers we have done. Next, you write down thermoplastic, the third type. We have thermoplastics. Write down. The polymers in which the intermolecular force, of attraction are in between elastomers and fibers. So moderate we have here. These are linear polymers. Hard at room temperature. And become soft and viscous on heating. And again become rigid on cooling. Okay. They become soft and viscous on heating and again become rigid in cooling. Okay. Example you write down. Polyethylene, polypropylene, polystyrene. PVC, Teflon, polyacrylonitrile. Okay. There's a term that we use here is plasticizers. Okay, write down that term in this only, plasticizers. Definition of plasticizers, you write down. Those plastics which do not get soft very much on heating, can be made soft and workable by addition of certain organic compound called plasticizers. Those plastics which do not get soft very much on heating can be made soft and workable by the addition of certain organic compounds called plasticizers. Okay. There are some examples of plasticizers you must remember. Dialkyl phthalates. Dialkyl phthalates is a one kind of plasticizers. Okay, examples you must remember. Next line write down PVC. PVC is extremely stiff. PVC, polyvinyl chloride, is extremely stiff and hard. Extremely stiff and hard, but the addition of di and butyl phthalate, this one, di and butyl, phthalate. This is the general name. This is one specific example we are taking. Okay. PVC is extremely stiff and hard, but the addition of dialbutyl phthalate, in short, in bracket you write down, we also call it as DBP, dialbutyl phthalate, makes it soft and rubber-like. Makes it soft and rubber-like. Okay. Dioctyl phthalate is the another example. Dioctyl phthalate, in short we write it DOP, is the another example of this plasticizers. Okay, structure of this, you see phthalic acid is this benzene ring. And we have COOH here. But that H you remove by butyl group, C4H9. It becomes DBP. C4H9. Okay, octyl is what? C8H17 you need to put here. So this is the structure of octyl, COO, C8H17, COO, C8H17. This is DOP and this is DBP. This two plasticizers you must remember. Okay, so this is one thing. Cresyl phosphate also we use as a plasticizers. Another example, the last one you write down. Cresyl phosphate, the structure is this. Me, and here we have O, P double bond O, OH, double bond O. This is orthocresyl phosphate, another plasticizers. Okay, so these three examples you must remember. Done.
Yes, sir.
Last one you write down. is thermosetting polymers, the fourth type. Thermosetting polymers. Write down, these are semi-fluid substance with low molecular weight which when heated undergo a change in chemical composition. Okay, semi-fluid substance with low molecular weight, which when heated, undergo a change in chemical composition to give a hard and insoluble mass. The hardness is because of extensive cross-linking. Okay, so cross-linking is again that's the same thing. We have a bond between the two layer. Okay, so when you heat this, chemical change takes place and cross-linking occurs, and hence it becomes hard. Okay, so these are the four different types of polymers we have, and this classification is based upon the forces involved in it. Okay, right. Next, you see, heading you write down, rubber. Classification is, this is done. Next is rubber. Okay. There are two types of rubber we have. One is natural, other one is synthetic. Okay, so natural rubber, write down. Two types of rubber we have, natural and synthetic rubber. Natural rubber are those which are available in nature. Available in nature, and it is obtained from rubber tree, and from this we'll get a material, we call it as latex material. You must have heard about it. Latex material, And from this, we obtain rubber. Okay, so it is available in nature, basically. Okay, synthetic rubbers are what? These are man-made. Synthetic rubbers are man-made. The example of natural rubber is natural rubber. The one example we have is polyisoprene. Polyisoprene. Okay, polyisoprene. What is the monomer of this? Can you tell me?
Isoprene.
Isoprene. The structure of isoprene is what? CH2 double bond C, single bond CH3, CH double bond CH2. This is isoprene. And when this goes under polymerization, it forms polyisoprene. Polyisoprene, the structure is this. CH2, C double bond, CH, CH3, CH2, and the open-ended side, N. Okay, this actually you can understand by free radical mechanism. This bond pair comes over here, this goes here, this comes over here, this goes here. So this and this forms a double bond here, and this is then open, and we have this thing. So this is the repeating unit. Okay. Now, can you tell me, do this molecule, does this molecule show GI, geometrical isomerism? Yes or no?
Yes.
How?
Because I don't know. It's like the groups are what all is, different.
No, what is the condition for a double bond to show geometrical isomerism? There's a condition. Okay. And what is that condition? If you have C double bond C and both the carbon has two different group attached, means the group attached at each carbon atom must be different. Then across this double bond, we have two isomer possible, cis and trans. Okay. This is the condition of double bond to show GI. We can have AB, CD also, but we cannot have AA here. That is not possible. This two must be different. This two must be different. That is what we have here. You see, this is CH3. And obviously, this is a different group. It is not CH3. And this carbon has one hydrogen and one different group. So across this double bond, we can say that there is GI possible. Geometrical isomerism possible. So it has two form here. One is cis, other one is trans. The cis form of this is soft in nature, and the trans one is comparatively hard. This cis form of this molecule only we use in rubber. Okay. This is only used in rubber. And we call it as heavy rubber. heavy rubber. Okay, a transformer is hard in nature. This we do not use in a rubber, and we call it as gutta percha. GUTTA. Must remember this name. GUTTAPRCHA. Okay, so polyisoprene is this. The cis form of polyisoprene, the cis form of this is the natural rubber. Done. Finish.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Synthetic rubber, man-made rubber, there are many examples. The second one you write down. Synthetic rubber. Man-made. Okay. So the first example of this is butadiene rubber. Butadiene rubber. Butadiene is the monomer, and its structure is what? CH2 double bond CH, single bond CH, double bond CH2. And when you do the polymerization of it, you'll get CH2, CH double bond CH. This is a polymer of this. Okay. And this we call it as polybutadiene. Polybutadiene. Okay. Now, the another example of this is neoprene. Neoprene. And the monomer of this neoprene is chloroprene. The structure is CH double bond CCl. CH double bond CH2. The name of this compound is chloroprene. Okay, and when you do the polymerization of it, you'll get again the similar way CH2 CH double bond CH CH2. We have chlorine here. And this is n times. The name of this one is, since it is chloroprene, so this one is polychloroprene. Polychloroprene, which we also call it as neoprene. Okay. Done. Can you go to the next page?
Yes, sir.
Third example. Third Third one we have is styrene butadiene rubber. Styrene butadiene rubber. Can you tell me the monomer of this? Yeah, what happened? Monomer is what? Monomer is styrene and butadiene. Styrene butadiene rubber, we also write it as SBR in short. Monomers are what? One of the monomer is styrene, and we know the structure of styrene. We have done it already. CH2 double bond, CH, and here we have a benzene ring. This is styrene. And this combines with butadiene. Butadiene is this CH2 double bond, CH, single bond CH, double bond CH2. Okay. This we take around 25% in the mixture, and this will be 75% in the mixture. Okay, and then it forms, under polymerization, it forms CH2, CH, CH2, CH double bond, CH single bond, CH2. This is the molecule we get. We also call it as, actually when you heat this, we use sodium as a catalyst here, any catalyst in this process. And that is why this molecule is also known as Buna S. This BU stands for butadiene, S stands for styrene, and Na is the catalyst, that is sodium. That's why we call it as Buna S. So the monomer of Buna S is what? Styrene and butadiene. Catalyst is sodium. Okay. Structure is this. Done.
Yes, sir.
The fourth one we have acrylonitrile. And butadiene rubber. So what is the monomer of this? Acrylonitrile and butadiene. The structure of acrylonitrile is what? CH2, double bond CH, and here we have CN, plus butadiene is CH2 double bond CH, single bond CH, double bond CH2. Heat this in presence of sodium catalyst. The structure is CH2CH, CN, CH2CH double bond CH, single bond CH2, and that is what we get. And we also call it as Buna N. Butadiene sodium nitrile, acrylonitrile. Okay. Next, write down. We use a catalyst to get the ordered structure of any polymer. And that catalyst we call it as Ziegler-Natta catalyst. Okay. What is this Ziegler-Natta catalyst? First of all, the formula you should remember. Okay. It is titanium chloride, the mixture of TiCl4 with trialkyl aluminium, AlR3. Trialkyl aluminium. R group is the alkyl group. Generally, we take ethyl, but it can be anything actually. Okay. So, if I draw a polymeric structure of polypropylene, okay. So, propylene, the structure is this CH2 double bond, CH3. This is propylene, and the polymerization of this gives this structure CH2 CCH3 H CH2 CCH3 H, and this side we have. Okay, like this it goes. Do we have any chiral carbon in this molecule? This is polypropylene. Do we have any chiral carbon in this? Tell me.
No.
I think we have the first one.
How many, at least in these, this structure where two molecules have joined? How many chiral carbon we have?
I think except for that middle CH2, they're chiral.
But then aren't the same groups repeated? So after in the left side, CH2 is attached to.
After this CH2, again we have CCH3H. See, this carbon
then cannot won't be chiral. Then won't it be same on both the sides?
Yeah, this side also we have CH2 and then the same thing. Means this is a repeating unit actually. This carbon is not a chiral carbon because it has two hydrogen on it. Okay. What about this carbon? We have one molecule, this hydrogen, one molecule is this, and another molecule is this. Okay. Symmetrical arrangement we are not considering. Got it. We are considering what? We are considering if the number of carbon on this side and this side is different, then this carbon is the chiral carbon we have. Okay. Or for this molecule, you see when we have dimer this, then this carbon for at least this one is chiral carbon because this group is this and this we have this side. Similarly, this carbon is also a chiral carbon. Okay. Yes. No.
Yes, sir.
all the alternate carbon, which has four different group attached with it, are the chiral carbon. So now when it is chiral carbon, so this CH3 and H, which is attached to this chiral carbon, their arrangement can be anything. Okay. So that arrangement we are trying to understand here. So what is the arrangement we have here? You see, one possible arrangement is this. Okay. One possibility is what, all CH3 present on the same side like this. And one arrangement is what, one CH3 coming out of the plane, other one is going into the plane, then out of the plane, into the plane, alternate. And here we do not have any fixed arrangement. It is randomly arranged like this. Okay. There is no fixed arrangement here. Okay. Because we do not have any control in such reaction. Like I discussed about this. Free radical mechanism we have, we do not have control on these reactions. So we can get any one of these possibilities, okay? Whether the one possible arrangement is what? All CH3 on the same side, then alternate, and then random arrangement. Overall point I'm trying to make is what? That the possibility is to get either ordered arrangement or disordered arrangement. Both possibility are there, okay? So when all the CH3 group present on the same side, okay, this arrangement we call it as isotactic arrangement. Isotactic arrangement when all CH3 on the same side. When it is alternate like this, it is syndiotactic. Syndiotactic. And when there is no arrangement, random arrangement, if it is there, it is random arrangement. So this random arrangement, we call it as atactic. Atactic. So these two are actually regular arrangement, right? Whether it is iso or syndiotactic, the arrangement, there is a pattern, regular arrangement we have. Okay, so this regular arrangement they have good physical properties, because ordered arrangement we have, so their physical property is better, good, and useful also. Since the physical property is good, high density we have, so it, this one is useful also. Both isotactic and syndiotactic, both are useful. They have good physical properties because they have ordered arrangement. Arrangement will have a fixed pattern here. This one also and this one also. But random arrangement, their physical property is not good. Not good physical properties. That's why we'll try to avoid, and this is not useful also, since the physical property is not good. That's why we try to avoid this particular arrangement, atactic arrangement. Okay. And to avoid this arrangement, we use a catalyst, and that catalyst we call it as Jiglar-Natta catalyst. Got it? So this point you write down. The structure of the structure of polymers depends upon the type of mechanism. The structure of the polymer depends upon the type of mechanism. Next line. In free radical mechanism, there is no control over the reaction. And the possibility to get the random arrangement of molecules is high. The possibility to get random arrangement, irregular arrangement of molecule is high. This structure is known as atactic structure. And their physical property is not good. And hence they are not useful. Okay, this structure is known as atactic structure. Their physical property is not good. Hence they are not useful. Next line, to get regular arrangement, we use a catalyst called Jiggler-Natta catalyst. Okay. To get regular arrangement, we use a catalyst called Jiggler-Natta catalyst. Done. Can we move on?
Yeah.
Okay. The last thing here we have to discuss in this chapter is write down resins. What are resins? Anything you know about resins? What are resins?
Some plant product.
Plant product. You must have seen on the tree, there's some yellowish orange color, semi-liquid substance is there. Right, some tree. I have seen it. I don't know whether you have seen it or not. So it is semi solid. It's not completely liquid, not completely solid. You can, change the shape also easily by applying some pressure on it. That's not a big deal. Okay, so that yellowish or orange colored liquid that you have obtained from the tree, those things we call it as resins. Okay, the examples of resins are The first example is bakelite. Okay, bakelite is an example of resins. You see this. It is actually the product of, or the monomer of bakelite is phenol and formaldehyde. Formaldehyde, and hence the, we also call it as phenol formaldehyde polymer, okay, or phenol formaldehyde resins. Bakelite is nothing but phenol formaldehyde resins, okay. So this reaction, actually reaction between phenol and formaldehyde, it takes place at in both acidic and basic medium. Mechanism, like I said, it is not required. I'll just discuss a little bit here. H plus OH minus, and it forms ortho para substituted product, which is OH, and here we have CH2OH, ortho substituted product, and para substituted product is this OH and CH2OH. Now the reaction takes place at both position, ortho and para. These two reacts OH, CH2OH reacts with CH2OH just a second. Reacts with CH2OH. OH. So this actually, and in acidic medium, this goes out at H2O. It combines and gives this product. OH ring. Here we have CH2. OH, CH2, this also goes this way. Like this, we'll get a long chain compound. This kind of reaction is possible at this position also. So overall, you'll get this product. It's a very complex reaction. I'm not writing down the entire reaction here. You'll get something like this. OH will have here. And you get CH2. This also attached with CH2. OH, and this CH2 attached with this. There's an open bond here. CH2 this side. This is structure, the entire complex structure is nothing but bakelite. Structure is not at all important. This is used for the production of pressure cooker handle. And it is a cross-linked thermosetting polymer. Right? It is a cross-linked thermosetting polymers. Thermosetting polymers means what? When we heat this, cross-linking takes place, which does not break down on cooling. That's why it does not become soft again. The other examples of resins are phenol formaldehyde, we have seen already. The other one is melamine formaldehyde polymer. Just name you write down. Melamine formaldehyde, I'll write down the name. Other examples of resins are melamine plus formaldehyde. And one more we have urea plus formaldehyde. All these are examples of resins. Melamine structure, you must remember. This has been asked in JEE exam. The structure-based question of melamine. Here we have NH2. Here we have NH2. And double bond like this. This is the structure of melamine. Question that they ask, how many lone pairs are present in melamine? Can you tell me the number of lone pair in melamine? Number of lone pairs in melamine.
Is it 6?
Yes.
6
lone pairs. One lone pair on each nitrogen atom. The exact question they have asked in JEE exam. But they haven't given the structure of melamine. The name they have written. The question is, count the number of lone pair present in melamine. Okay, so structure you must know, because when the structure is given, there's nothing to do in this. Okay, so this is it for polymers. Okay, polymers is done. Let me see if one or two things are there. One question we'll see. No, we have done it. Okay. This is it for polymers. Okay. What should we start next? Shall we start surface chemistry?
Anything is fine, sir.
So you can finish off nucleic acid.
Nucleic acid. Okay. Last class in biomolecules, I have discussed that average molecular mass, how to find out those things. The formula is there, no? Have you finished that? Average molecular mass percentage, and then
yeah, in the last you gave the formula.
Yeah, yeah.
It was the
yeah,
last.
Yeah. Yeah, we have done this, no? Okay, take care. Okay, So we'll do nucleic acid. Nucleic acid. Do you have NCERT book with you now?
Yeah.
Open it. What is the content given in nucleic acid there? Just tell me the topic name.
Chemical composition of nucleic acid.
Okay.
Structure of nucleic acid.
Just a second. Wait. Yeah. Chemical composition is given, then
structure and biological functions.
Structure of nucleic acids and biological functions, right? Okay. There are a few structures. What is the name of the structure given? They are given pyrimidine, cytosine, uracil, thymine.
Yeah, adenine, guanine.
Yeah.
Guanine, adenine. Okay, and those structure actually you have to again memorize.
Sir, is nucleic acid very important from JEE point of view?
I don't think it's very important because it is mainly, you know, important for NEET aspirants. Okay, they ask questions in NEET. I mean, structure-based questions, replication and all, they won't ask in JEE. A structure of compounds that you have, that you should know. Like the all name that I have taken, no? That you should know. Like the heredity, the genetic code and all, that is not required for JEE. So what is important here is to know the structure of the different molecules. Okay, adenine, guanine, those things, like I told you just now, melamine, they have asked number of lone pairs and all. So like that, they can give you some name of the compound in integer type questions. Find out the, you know, the lone pair present in thymine, this kind of question they ask. Okay, so a structure-based question they ask. Function-wise, they don't ask because that is then goes to the NEET, the biology things and all. Okay, so you see here, we'll just finish it. What is a nucleic acid? See, when we talk about the living cells, okay, these living cells contains nucleoproteins, okay? Now, these nucleoproteins are actually forms by the combination forms with proteins actually in combination with biopolymers of another type of nucleic acids. Okay. So actually the nucleic acid has, there are two types of nucleic acid. You know that DNA and RNA, right? What is the, DNA, what is the full form of DNA?
Deoxyribonucleic acid.
Okay. RNA is ribonucleic acid. So the nucleic acid is actually, write down, I'll go to the next page here. A structure of DNA and RNA, you can go through the book. It's a complex structure, helical thing and all that you can go through. It is not required here. I won't draw it. It's very complex. It's very difficult to draw also. Okay. That is structure you can go through. What are linkages all there? I'll explain that. So open the book and look at the structure when I'm explaining it. Okay. I'll tell you. So nucleic acids are what? These are the compounds, write down, which are made up of proteins and with the biopolymers of another type of compounds. Okay, so proteins and another kind of biopolymers, if they mix, it forms nucleic acid. So it is a mixture of proteins and other types of biopolymers. Okay, it is of two types, like I said, DNA and RNA. DNA is ribonucleic acid, and RNA is ribonucleic acid. Okay. Next line. These are basically long chain polymers of nucleotides. Okay. It is basically the long chain polymers of nucleotides. Next, write down the chemical composition of nucleic acid. Chemical composition of nucleic acid. Write down hydrolysis of nucleic acid. Whether you take DNA or RNA, both. Hydrolysis of this gives pentose sugar. Hydrolysis gives pentose. This is what you need to memorize. So when you go through the NCERT book, these kind of information you must keep in mind. Okay. Pentose sugar. Okay. See, there are two types of heterocyclic nitrogenous base present in this molecule. Like you see the structure. There are two structures we have. The basic thing is pentose. And pentose structure, we have already discussed in the fructose thing, right? So the structure of beta D ribose, which is used in ribonucleic acid, I'll draw here. So I'll draw the structure and write down the name. And it is a three-dimensional structure. Three-dimensional structure. So this bond, this carbon is actually coming towards the observer, this one. Okay. This is coming towards the observer. At this carbon, we have OH on the top, H on the bottom. Here we have H on the top, OH on the bottom, H on the top, OH on the bottom, H on the bottom. CH2OH on the top. This structure is beta D ribose and it is used in RNA, ribonucleic acid. Another structure you draw which is the exact structure this you draw here. Oxygen again, it is coming towards the observer. Just a second.
What? C4H7Br2. Achha, so it is then Br2 or Br? C4H7, so 8 into 10. Plus 2, 9. Achha. So it is a dihalide, so there are many structures possible actually. C4H7Br2, you said, no? Achha, Param, you give me some time because I am in class right now. I have class till 1 o'clock. After that, I'll send you. Just drop me a text on WhatsApp, I'll send you, okay? After 1 o'clock, I have class till then. Okay. Yeah.
So the structure is beta D ribose and beta D deoxyribose. Okay, so this one is beta D ribose we have drawn. This one is beta deoxyribose. The structure here we have OH and this side we have hydrogen. This carbon has two hydrogen. Is this a structure given in NCRT? Can you check once? OH, H here. And here we have hydrogen, CH2OH.
It's given, sir.
This structure is correct. No, this carbon has two hydrogen.
Yeah.
Yeah. The name of this compound is beta D ribose. Sorry, deoxyribose. Deoxyribose in DNA. These two structures we have. So pentose, actually it has, the reference compound is pentose only, okay, which has this ring, which exists in these two form in DNA and RNA, okay? So there are two base actually here. Like I said, the full hydrolysis of DNA and RNA gives a pentose sugar, okay? Ribose in RNA and deoxy in DNA, deoxyribose in DNA. Two kinds of heterocyclic nitrogenous base is present in it, okay? The base that we take, okay? One is, they give pentose sugar, and other one that we get here. So the pentose sugar structure I have drawn two types, and the other one we get on hydrolysis. On hydrolysis, it gives two kinds of heterocyclic nitrogenous base. Write down two heterocyclic nitrogenous base. I am just giving you the chemistry aspect of it, the reaction of it, nitrogenous base. Okay, that we call it as the two nitrogenous base that we get here is purines and pyrimidines. Purines and pyrimidines. And apart from this, we also get phosphoric acid. This is what you need to memorize, a product. Phosphoric acid. Now the important thing here that you already know, we have done this in biomolecules. This is first carbon, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5th. Here also the same thing. 1, 2, 4, and 5th. What you have to keep in mind that C2 carbon in this deoxyribose, C2 carbon does not contain OH group. This you must remember. It is not present at C2 carbon. Okay. Now, these two structure you must know, pyrimidine and purines, okay? Next one, we'll draw the structure of these two. Pyrimidine structure is this. We have a ring, nitrogen. This is the structure of pyrimidine, alternate double bond. And I'll write down the name here, pyrimidine. And the another one is purine. Purine structure is similar to pyrimidine, which is this. I missed one thing. Here we have nitrogen, here we have nitrogen. So pyrimidine, we have this structure. Two nitrogen atoms. Here also we have nitrogen atom. 1, 2, and 3. So pyrimidine is this. So this is also pyrimidine. But apart from this, we'll have a 5-membered ring here, which has one nitrogen present here, another nitrogen present here, and these two are attached like this. It's a 5-membered ring here. So we have a double bond here, and then nitrogen we have here, so one hydrogen this side. This structure is purine. Okay, I'll draw 2-3 more structure into this, because you see what happens in pyrimidine, it has a single heterocyclic ring. Pyrimidine is this single heterocyclic ring, and purines have fused ring, we can say, heterocyclic two rings. One is this 5-member ring and this 6-member ring, two fused ring we have. So DNA, that deoxyribose nucleic acid, DNA, has the purine base and pyrimidine base. Both base will have in DNA, but not exactly the same molecule, but the base of this, the purine base, is adenine and guanine, which is present in DNA, and pyrimidine base is thymine and cytosine, which is present in DNA. But in RNA, it contains uracil instead of thymine. In RNA, we have uracil present, not thymine is not present over there. And it is important to note that there are two key structural differences between DNA and RNA. Okay. DNA contains deoxyribose, while RNA has only ribose sugar. That's what we have discussed last page only. The difference between DNA and RNA, the main difference, which is a very important point here, DNA has thymine, while RNA has uracil. Okay, so that's what we will write now. First, we'll draw these structures of adenine, uracil, thymine, guanine. You should know all these structures. Okay, so with pyrimidine, you have three different bases we get here. With respect to this, the reference compound is this, and with this, we'll get three different bases. The first one you write down from this only, this way, from pyrimidine. The first one is this, we'll have a six-membered ring. This one. Here we have double bond O, and here we have double bond O. An alternate double bond is not present in the ring. We have a double bond only here. Okay, so CH double bond CH, this double bond O. And we have H here, and here also we have NH. Trivalency of nitrogen was to complete. This compound, we call it as uracil. The structure you must remember, name is not enough. Because once they have asked melamine, they can ask you any one of these structures also. Uracil is represented by the symbol U, capital U. Now this one, we have cytosine. Cytosine, the difference is what? Instead of this C double bond O, we have NH2 present here. So the structure is this. NH2. This is the structure of cytosine, represented by capital C. One more structure we have, and that is thymine. Thymine is, everything is same with respect to this if you see, but the only thing, only difference is here we do not have one hydrogen, but one CH3 present onto this carbon. The structure is this. Nitrogen we have here. Double bond O, double bond O. Here we have double bond. Here we have CH3, NH, and NH. This structure is thymine. That is T. Okay. This is the structure of the three bases of pyrimidine, which is present in DNA. Purine, the two base we have, that is adenine. The structure is this. We'll draw this structure with NH2 over here. Okay, so the structure will be this. N. Double bond here, double bond here, and double bond here. This carbon has NH2, and this is attached with one nitrogen. This. So we have hydrogen here and double bond here. Okay, hydrogen, double bond, and this structure is adenine. It is A. And guanine, the structure is, just you write down this structure in guanine. Here you write down C double bond O. I'll write down the structure here. This guanine is important. Here we have C double bond O. And here we have NH2. Double bond, nitrogen, hydrogen here. And this will be as it is. Nitrogen this side, nitrogen this side, and both are attached with double bond CH. Hydrogen we have here. This structure is guanine. That is G. Finish this structure, let me know. I'll just dictate you 2-3 points here.
Done,
so write down. Pyrimidine contains a single heterocyclic ring. Pyrimidine contains a single heterocyclic ring, while purines have two heterocyclic ring fused together. Purines have two heterocyclic ring fused together. You see, this is the two ring we have, no? Two heterocyclic, this is one heterocyclic ring, another heterocyclic ring. Two heterocyclic ring fused together. DNA contains the purine bases, in bracket you write down adenine and guanine. DNA contains the purine bases, in bracket write down adenine and guanine. Purine bases, adenine, guanine, and pyrimidine bases, in bracket, thymine and cytosine. So uracil is not present in DNA. Okay. And pyrimidine bases, thymine and cytosine. Okay. So uracil, it is not present in DNA. Next line, RNA contains uracil instead of thymine. Okay, RNA contains uracil, not thymine. So this thymine, it is not present in RNA. This is the another point. Okay. All these compounds that I have written, uracil, cytosine, okay, thymine, all these are bases, right? And it gives nucleoside, means nucleoside of adenine is adenosine. Okay. How do you get nucleoside? Nucleosides are the N-glucosides of purine and pyrimidine bases. Okay. Just you write down next point. I'll draw the structure. You will understand this. Write down next line. Nucleosides are N-glycosides of purine. Nucleosides are N-glycosides sites of purine or pyrimidine bases with pentose sugar. So this is the definition of nucleoside, pentose sugar. What are nucleosides? We have a pentose sugar, and that is linked with purine or pyrimidine base with N-glycosidic linkage. Okay. So what do you mean by this N-glycosidic linkage? Suppose if I draw the structure of sugar here, which is this. This is a structure of sugar. I won't draw the entire thing here. Right. So we have all these bonds present. OH, H, you can put it on here. CH2OH like this we have here. And this carbon, this C1, actually, it is attached with the base like this. Nitrogen, and then the ring we have like this. Okay. Write down here base, N base. So this link is what? This link is the N-glycosidic bond. N-glycosidic bond. So these are nucleosides actually. So when you take adenine as a base, the nucleoside is adenosine. So with base, what is the name of nucleoside we have? I'll write down here. Base one side, and the name of nucleoside this side. So if the base is adenine, nucleoside is adenosine. If the base is guanine, nucleoside is guanosine. Cytosine, it's cytidine. Thymine, thymidine. Uracil, it is uridine. So the point is, this reference compound is pentose only. This is not going to change. But base can be changed. If the base is this, corresponding nucleoside is this, the name I have written. Similarly, nucleotides are what? The last thing here we discuss is nucleotides. Okay, a structure of DNA is a double helix structure that you can go through. Okay, structure of DNA, Okay, so this is nucleosides, you should know. Next we'll discuss is, all of you have written this?
Yeah.
Okay. Similarly, nucleosides, like I discussed, it is the, you know, the combination of purine or pyrimidine base with pentose sugar. And this base and sugar is connected with N-glycosidic linkage. Nucleosides is this. Similarly, nucleotides also we can define. Okay, so what is nucleotide? Write down. Nucleotide is a phosphate ester of nucleosides a nucleotide is a phosphate ester of nucleoside which contains a purine or pyrimidine base. Okay. Which contains a purine or pyrimidine base with five, write it like this, purine and pyrimidine base with a sugar, contains 5 carbon atoms. Okay. One thing I'll repeat here in the last page, that this structure is a base. It is not the actual structure. I have just drawn this to make you understand what is N-glycosidic bond. Suppose adenine base you are taking. So here we have the structure of adenine. Guanine, then the structure of guanine. So this is just a base where this N bond is joined with this carbon. So it is not any, correct structure is this. It is not the correct structure because we have 2 nitrogen present in the ring, all these, if you see. That's what the meaning of this. Anyways, so next thing is what? This nucleotides, like I said, it has one base, right? Purine or pyrimidine base plus 5-membered sugar plus phosphate. And then it forms nucleotide, okay? If I draw the structure here of a nucleotide, the structure will be like this. Okay, C1 carbon, we have hydrogen here, and this contains one, like I said, one base. So this is the base I am using here. Double bond O. Here we have double bond. Here we have double bond. And here we have NH2. So this is one base we have connected with C1. OH, H, this is the sugar we have, pentose. So OH, H. And here we have H, CH2. OH we have in general, but it is connected with a phosphate. Okay, so this point, it is linked with a phosphate ion, which is P double bond O, O minus, single bond O minus. So phosphate, sugar, 5-membered ring, and a base. This thing is nucleotides. Okay, so base is there. This one is sugar. And this one is phosphate. They won't ask you the structure. You should know the definitions of nucleotides. However, this is also not that much important. Okay. Okay.
Yes, sir.
One note you write down. Nucleotides are linked together. Nucleotides are linked together by phosphodiester linkage. Phosphodiester linkage between 5th and 3rd carbon atom of pentose sugar. Okay, this is the last thing you have to keep in mind. A structure also you can draw. 2 phosphate group you have to attach at 5th and 3rd carbon. Okay. On pentose sugar. Like you see, here we have this group attached here. Okay. One more if you attach this side. Okay. This gives you phosphodiester linkage. Here, this group present at this carbon, 3rd carbon. This is 3rd and this is 5th carbon. So this is the way the nucleotides are linked together. This is one nucleotide molecule. At this point, the another nucleotides are linked. Okay, so like that, you'll get a very big complex structure. NCERT, I don't know whether it is given or not, this structure. But all these things you don't have to draw. You should know the key points that I have given you, that nucleotides are linked together by phosphodiester linkage. This term is important. Phosphodiester linkage between third and fifth carbon. Okay. So this is it. After this, we have function of DNA and RNA, which is not required. But I'll suggest you to go through once through NCERT. That is more than enough. Okay.
Yes, sir.
This is done. Nothing is there. Okay. So what we do next? We have half an hour more. Tell me. Any doubt you have? What?
No doubt, sir.
Okay. One question you solve then. One last question. We will finish it early today. Not from this, some other things we'll see. Did you write the test yesterday? This KVPY test? Yes or no?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
One question was there. Let me give you that question. Wait.
So there was this one question as to Friedel-Crafts alkylation, what it means.
What?
It said there was this question in that test. It said Friedel-Crafts alkylation is, and then four options. What are aromatic nucleus and olefin?
Do you have that question now?
1 minute, I'll try pulling it.
You have your phone with you right now, all of you? Okay, let it be. I'll write down the question here. See, the question is 2.52 gram 2.52 gram of hydrated oxalic acid. Hydrated oxalic acid is oxalic acid with 2H2O. Hydrated oxalic acid was dissolved in dissolved in 100 ml of water. 100 ml of H2O. 10 ml of this solution. 10 ml of this solution was diluted to 500 ml find normality of the final solution. Normality and the amount of oxalic acid present in the final solution. Do this. What is the answer you got, Shreya?
That 0.08 thing.
Did you get the option right?
Yeah.
How? Do it now. Shreya, the question is there.
It was dehydrated, not hydrated.
Yes, the question is there, dehydrated. Okay. But with dehydrated, it means the molecular mass should be what?
63.
Should be 19, right? Dehydrated means what? I have given here hydrated oxalic acid. Okay. I did not check this because the solution was given over there, no? Their solution, the molecular mass they have taken as 126, correct?
Yeah.
126. But in the question, they have given dehydrated. So when it is dehydrated, it means the mass, molecular mass should be what, 90?
Oh, I switched both, sir, by mistake. That's why I was getting the answer.
Yeah, so when you get this dehydrated oxalic acid, if you take, okay, then the answer will be something else. It is not there in the option. Okay. Answer is something else which is not given in the option. So you try this. Hydrated means molecular mass is this. Number of equivalents will be what? Mass divided by equivalent mass. 2.52 divided by equivalent mass E. So equivalent mass of oxalic acid is what? If it is hydrated, I am going through the options. So through the solution which is given. Okay. Taking this as hydrated. 2.52 divided by 126 divided by 2. N factor is 2 for oxalic acid. Okay. This you will get this by 63. That will be 0.04. Yes or no?
No, correct. Sir, it's 0.08 only.
So number of equivalents will be what? 0.04 divided by 100 ml into 1000. That will be 0.4. This is 0.4. Now we use N1V1 is equals to N2V2. So N1V1 is 0.4 into volume is what? 10 ml of this solution is diluted. No, so into 10 and 2 into volume is 500. So when you solve this N2, you'll get 0.008, which is not there in the option. Okay.
Yeah, but I thought it'd be the closest, like this 0.8, so that's why I marked okay. That.
Fine, no issue. So this is a normality you'll get. And this normality, when you try to find out the mass is equals to equivalent by volume of solution is 500 into 1000. So number of equivalents you'll get here is around 0.004. which is mass by equivalent mass of oxalic acid, 63. And this is coming to be around 0.252 gram, which is not there in the option. Okay. So this we get when you are taking molecular mass is 26. And for this, the question should be hydrated oxalic acid. This is one thing. Correct. If it is dehydrated, then molecular mass is what, 90? Okay, so this will get here what? For dehydrated, if you try to do, then the number of equivalents is what? Number of equivalents is 2.52 given mass divided by the equivalent mass, and that will be 2.52 divided by 90 divided by 2. What is this value? Tell me.
Point zero five six
you are getting. Okay. So normality is what? 0.056 divided by volume is 100 into 1000. This will be 0.56 normal, correct? Now 0.56 into 10 is equals to 500 into N. N2 is what? 0.56 into 10 divided by 500. What is this value?
Point zero one one,
which is again not there in the option, right? I don't think 0.011 is there in the option. Is it?
No.
So that's why the answer was wrong. Okay. I think when you look at the data, it should be hydrated oxalic acid. Then you see this equivalent weight is getting cancelled and we are getting proper 0.04 equivalent here. 63, 252 by 63. We're getting points. So it should be hydrated oxalic acid. Tell me anything else? Anything else?
No, sir.
Chalo, then we'll wind up, okay? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay, chalo. We'll see you tomorrow, probably. We'll have a class, most probably. We'll let you know by evening. And we'll start P block tomorrow. Yes, okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.